life is all about taking those L's, because you have to take those risks. And those small L's, like, if you, it's that's what life is. That's what human experiences are, which is, how are you going to go through life with these mistakes or with these hurdles or with these, whatever you want to call them. So it's just like, this is all, we all going through something. We all going through something. So the best thing we can do is look on the brighter side and move forward, because life is already testing us every single freaking day, right? So like, this is just a test to our resilience and a test to our abilities to just look past the negative.
Michelle Macrohon is the founder of Subtle Filipino Traits, a Facebook group that was created with the purpose of connecting Filipinos globally, which now has more than 83,000 members and growing. Her passion for the Filipino community has opened up opportunities for her in leadership, partnerships, and hosting workshops at conferences. She is a content creator, a mental health advocate, and a DJ who goes by the name of Seduza. Let's welcome Michelle Macrohon.
Yo, what's up, Michelle? Thank you so much for being here. It's a gift and an honor to have you.
Thank you, Romeo. I am honored to be here and to share my story, and I'm grateful to be talking to you right now.
Excellent. So I want the world to know who you are and what you do, but before we get into all that, let's start from the beginning. Where did you grow up? What school did you go to? And so on.
Okay. So thank you again for having me. My name is Michelle Macrohon. So I am a Filipino-Chinese American. I was born in Southern California, in the outskirts of LA, in a city called Pomona. And now I reside in a city called Fontana, which is inland of LA. And growing up, I had divorced parents. My mom is like my father and my mother. I'm the oldest of two younger sisters, two beautiful little princesses. And then I also live with my aunt currently. So we're a house full of females. Growing up, I actually moved a lot. So I went to multiple elementaries. I went to two different high schools. I'm grateful for the opportunity, for sure. And then in college, I went to the University of California, Santa Barbara, where I majored in Asian American Studies. I was an education minor and a technology management certificate.
All right, so what would you say are some of the biggest dreams you had as a kid?
Oh yeah, growing up, I was for the most part an only child until I was like 10 or 12. And I think growing up, one of the things I noticed early on was that I was very rebellious, whether it's against my mom when I wanted to stay outside a long time, but also in regards to school, I loved education, but I also kind of was a troublemaker because I noticed that I liked to stand out. But I also like to make people laugh. And I also like to make sure that everyone was having a good time. So my dream was, one of my biggest dreams was to really just make it out. When I moved to Fontana, I noticed like, I don't want to be here for the rest of my life. And I know that, especially since college was such a pushed experience, I know that I wanted to make it out. Not necessarily because I wanted to leave home, because my mom sucks and my family sucks, but I just knew that I wanted to challenge myself growing up. I didn't have all the resources yet to understand what that really looks like moving forward, but I knew that I wanted to do the best I can with the abilities I had moving forward.
Right. Where do you think that rebelliousness came from?
I don't blame my mom for her level of care for me, especially because I was her first daughter. She wanted to protect me, but I didn't know in the phrase that challenging yourself is making yourself uncomfortable. I just kind of subconsciously just wanted to do it. Like I wanted to challenge myself because of the curiosity I had, and sometimes that just naturally aligned with the rebelliousness that came with rebelling against my mom's wishes. But like, for example, an example of that in the most like wholesome form is that she doesn't want me to go to UCS because she wants me to live at home and commute at UC Riverside. And that's, I've learned over time, that's a common factor that happens in Asian households sometimes. But it was out of the love of my mom, but also the love of my future for her. So it was like a kind of interesting cycle.
Right. And you going to UC Santa Barbara had to be one of the biggest decisions you had to make in your life. What would you say is another big decision you had to make along with living life?
Oh, I think about a few experiences where I had to decide that, but I think one of the most impactful decisions, hardest decisions, was when I resigned a leadership role I had essentially worked really hard for. And I think what comes with the resigning of such a huge leadership role to myself was just the scrutiny. It really challenged my perception of how I perceive what people are going to perceive of me, and perceiving of my opportunities and how I perceived if I'm prepared for the future outcome of the resignation. So a little bit of context, I was president of my housing my first year, which is my dorm. So then there's the overall organization that oversees all the students that live on the university campus. So I applied for that role. There goes that like rebelliousness again, because I'm this little Asian girl wanting for this huge position as a first year. Like, who is she? Like, does she even go here? But I loved going against the norm, because I think, you know, success isn't ageist. But going back to the resignation, I actually went to the Philippines after. So I ran again for that large position in my second year into my third year, and then I also had a fellowship that summer in the Philippines. And so when I did that fellowship, I realized my passion shifted, still for community, but for a specific community, which is a larger Filipino community. So when I came back and serving my large school campus, I realized I'm not as passionate as this, for this community. And how can I be honest about that? When I worked so hard for these benefits, I worked so hard for this role, these people I've worked hard to serve trust me, and I don't want to flake on them. But I think it was really me spending a Sunday morning to night in the library, writing down the pros and cons and realizing if my heart isn't here anymore, it's a disservice to the community. And it was hard. I was homeless for like a few weeks, worrying about where I'm going to live. I was sad that I had to leave a team. I had to deal with them and opening up about that, because sometimes leaving something or resigning feels like you're quitting. And I had to reconstructure how I perceive that and realize this is not just for me, this is for everyone. Because if I, like I said, if I'm not in this with my heart and my soul, like, it's just going to be a disservice.
Beautiful. And I'm sure you had mentors along the way. What would you say are some of the best pieces of advice you've received from a mentor?
Oh,
too.
My goodness. So there's a plethora of, I'm a super huge quotey person, but in regards to a few of them, I really appreciated was number one, to the only L's we take in life are lessons. And I think that goes kind of back to the story I previously stated about perceiving how I perceive my losses or when I feel most vulnerable and weak. I think when I feel weakened or I feel like I've lost something, right? Just taking a fat L, there's a self-pity phase sometimes for myself. There's a phase where I don't feel like I'm fulfilling myself or the people around me, and I just feel like I'm a blob. But when I revisit that quote, especially, because life is all about ups and downs, right? It's like, it's not this uphill forever. Like, it's life. I've rephrased and understand now as I've gotten older that life is all about taking those L's, because you have to take those risks. And those small L's, like, if that's what life is, that's what human experiences are, which is how are you going to go through life with these mistakes or with these hurdles or with these, whatever you want to call them. So it's just like, this is all, we all going through something. So the best thing we can do is look on the brighter side and move forward, because life is already testing us every single freaking day, right? So like, this is just a test to our resilience and a test to our abilities to just look past the negative. And but also another part of that is that acknowledging the demons I've had. I think another quote I really liked was, be friends with the dark, but feed the light. And I was like, oh my goodness. So like that's another part of human experience, is that there's always going to be darkness around us in some form or way, whether it's racism, whether it's biological catastrophes, whether it's ourselves. But I think for myself, it was the demons that live inside of me that try to tell me I'm not good enough, etc. I realized that's part of me that I have to befriend and face, rather than ignore that that's a human behavior or phenomenon.
100%. So let's say somebody, in fact, let's just talk about some like real situations, the state of the world, pandemic. A lot of people are in the state of worry, self-doubt, a lot more insecurities. They don't feel empowered to put themselves out there or to live out their passion or purpose. So what would you suggest is something a person can do to lift their confidence back up, to lift their self-esteem up so that they can push forward?
I love that question. From the experience of my own self in the battle, because I'm a huge advocate for mental health and self-love and the shared love to others. And one thing I would like to share is that self-love is the greatest gift we can give ourselves, 100%. And if you can, and you know, we hear these, oh, if you can't love yourself, you can't love anybody else. Yeah, I get that sentiment, but it's hard to love ourselves when the world is constantly bombarding us with, this is how you should look, this is what you should be doing, blah, 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 blah. So I totally get why people struggle with that. And I think that's the first step, is acknowledging, again, the human natural behavior of self-doubt versus like, oh, like I'm trying to like, I think what also aligns with, oh, I have so much to say about this, but I'm trying to make sure I'm clearly like expressing what I'm saying, which I struggle with sometimes. Number one is just be honest with yourself. And that also returns back to the be friends with everything that coexists in your gut, in your mind, in your heart. And so when you, it's kind of like a self-assessment. And then, so when you acknowledge, just ask yourself, why do I feel like this? Versus sit in this, like, I feel like this, and thinking about what I'm lacking. I don't have big butt. I don't have big boobs. I'm not smart enough. I don't have this job. But when you rephrase it, I was like, don't worry about what you don't have right now. And it's not to say that you shouldn't aspire to attain the goals that you want, but rephrase and sit there. And I think the question that we don't ask ourselves enough is, what do we like about ourselves? Is there anything that I can celebrate about myself? Because there is something that we're able to celebrate about each individual. I personally think that. I think there's good in everyone. And I think it just takes time for ourselves to acknowledge what we're great at and what we're not great at. And to realize we're not superhero, I mean, except my mom, no, I'm kidding. We can't be everything. Everyone is not everything. And everyone's not for everyone. So acknowledging like, what can I be good at? Okay, there's so much I can say about this.
My God. Say it all, say it all.
Oh gosh. But to return back to the question, what can we do to uplift each other, right? Oh my God, and ourselves. I'll speak, okay, what is something that I do? Something that I do that I've been practicing a lot is preserving my energy. I think for me during this time of COVID and recently, it's been a relief, not to say that I'm still sad about, you know, the certain circumstances, but again, going back to, well, we gotta look at the brighter side, because we can't control what we can't control, but you can control what you can control, is math, right? So when you're worried about something, for me, it's like, I have this issue, can I do something about it? No, all right, what can I do? Like, I can't, what can I do? I have an issue. Can I do something about it? Yeah. All right. Like, let's do something about it. But like a pause is that, again, that preserve your energy, like be patient. I think the biggest one is being patient with myself, that you're racing yourself. You're your biggest competition, is what I had to remind myself, because I can't change the way God like made me, like God made me this way. And I'm going to try to love what he's given me in the best way possible. Feed my soul with knowledge, feed my soul with quality people around me, which is another huge point in terms of what my happiness has been. Because it's not an independent experience of self-love and growth. It's been who I've surrounded myself with. And yeah. Oh, I can go that far.
Let's tackle on that next part, because I am going to get into subtle Filipino traits. Lifting yourself up, being around people, especially those that, you know, can give you encouraging words or can relate to what you've been through or are going through. Mm-hmm. And that and that relates to the word community, right?
Yeah.
Being a part of a community is huge. And so, like you said, this life is not meant to be lived alone. We're mm-hmm. meant to be helping each other. We're meant to be lifted by one another. And so one of the things that I do want to ask you is, first, why did you create Subtle Filipino Traits?
Oh man, I love revisiting this story, because to see where Subtle Filipino Traits is now is just mind-blowing to me. So I earlier stated that I resigned a position because I found a stronger passion to serve a community, which is the Filipino community, the global Filipino community. Previously, I've been in Filipino clubs, and I'm actually growing up, I wasn't a part of a huge Filipino community, i.e. it's predominantly Hispanic and Black, etc. And once I got to college and joined the Filipino club, I realized, oh, shoot, like this is what it means to be in a Filipino space that centers Filipino experiences and to uplift Filipino people. So quickly, serving for me looks like engagement, communicating, like I just wanted to talk to people. I wanted to understand the perspective. I wanted to see what their Filipino experience was, because everyone has a different experience regardless of stereotypes, right? And then I applied for a fellowship. But earlier on, I actually obtained a mentor, one of my first mentor, and one of probably the most impactful mentor I've had throughout my college career and then afterwards. And his name was Roland Ross Navarro. And he was actually an alumni of UCSB who was hugely involved in his Filipino clubs and hugely involved in serving the Filipino community. And quickly, he saw my drive, and I'm grateful for that, and took me in as a mentee and helped me see the bigger picture of community serving beyond just like the collegiate level. And through that, I was able to achieve the fellowship in the Philippines, or got to visit multiple cities. And I also got to see my family in the Philippines after a while. So moving forward, that was 2018, December, when I was in the Philippines, like before I came back. So if you also have heard, there's a group called Soto Asian Traits. And that, so I was also abroad in Singapore during that time, then visit the Philippines. I'm not trying to go too much in depth, but I hope that helps you understand the timeline. And I was in Singapore, like, what is this Soto Asian Traits? And I loved it because I was learning about, I'm also Chinese, right? So I'm learning about, and there's memes from, and stories from all types of people, Chinese, Korean, Japanese, etc. I'm like, this is dope. Like, people are being vulnerable. People are sharing their story. People are engaging in conversations about their opinions. Like, this is, I feed off this experience. I love Reddit. I love learning what people go through and how I can resonate or not resonate. So moving forward, I looked for some Filipino traits. I was like, is there a group for Filipinos? Because this just doesn't have enough Filipino for me. Like, I want more. Not to say that I'm judging it. Like, it is what it is for a global Asian community. But I want something Filipino, made Filipino for Filipinos. And I looked, there was actually a group. And I tried to join. I tried to message the admin, like, hey, like, what's the gist on this? Like, what are you trying to do with this? I didn't get a response. So I was like, this was January 2019. I'm like, okay, well, I have homies. I don't want to do this alone, because like we both understand that it takes a team to grow something. So I was like, okay, like, create a group, Subtle Filipino Traits. Invited some of my friends for the fellowship, invited my cousin and some of my classmates, started a team. I was creating memes. I was posting, hey y'all, like, what's good? Welcome to SFT. There's like no one in this group yet. I'm talking to myself. And I was just like, you know, like, this over time will grow, because this is a safe space I wanted to create, specifically a safe space for the Filipino, global Filipino community. to continue growing together and learning what that experience is. And I was really, really also inspired by Kumu. Kumu is the Filipino live streaming app that also, that is really what I was inspired from as well, which is to connect the Filipino, the global Filipino community. And Roland is actually the founder, one of the founders of that. So it just kind of made sense, like his impact on me to create that in my own way through a platform that's already kind of used by people on the globe.
Awesome. And so how many members are a part of this community now?
So we have roughly, last night I checked, about 83K.
That's so amazing. That started from you reaching out in the group and nobody was there to 83,000 members. That's beautiful. And that should be an inspiration to a lot of people. And I do want to ask you, because if there isn't a community, they, you know, people are a part of different communities, but they want to feel like they want to start their own community, right? Because they've been a part of these communities, they feel inspired to start their own. What would you say are one or two things that people can do to start their own community?
Given my experience now, I kind of think of like from the technical perspective, is like, okay, you want to start something, number one, anything is possible with the day and age of technology. You want to start a group to serve a specific niche of people, do it. Because if you're passionate about whatever it is, like water, right? You're Filipinos who love water, right? Filipinos who love architecture, right? Filipino creatives, which is already something that's been done. Don't be afraid to start, because don't be afraid to suck at something new, right? That's something I've like learned to accept in my mind. And at the end of the day, your community is a reflection of your investment though. So if you, for me, I had that vision and I expressed that vision. It's one thing to have a vision and dream of something, but how are you externalizing that? And how does what you're externalizing align with what's going on in here? And sometimes it's hard to externalize what's going on in here. So take your time to answer some of these questions. Who is the community you want to serve? What are your goals in uplifting, or what is your goals to do in this community? So who's that audience? And what is your investment in it? And give yourself tangible goals in serving this community or being a leader in this community. And always remember, like, you don't have to do this alone. You're trying to bring these people in. And don't be surprised when you're going to have contributors who appreciate what you've started. And then next you notice they're on your team, which is exactly what happened to SFT. A majority of the team that I started with left, and there's no problem with that. We didn't know what the scale was going to be later on, and we all have different lives. And I totally understand that. But our team now, we're all volunteer-based. No one gets paid for this shit, right? But we all do it with a universal goal, which is we love the community. We have something in us that wants to serve, and we want to share that time. And that's just so powerful that people from different parts of the globe, we have Malaysia, Canada, Australia, Pennsylvania, we have the Bay, we have the Philippines, and they want to just spend a few hours or whatever it is of their time to make sure this place is a place for us. And so I hope that gives you a little base if you're listening and if you want to start something to kind of push forward.
100%, because even if there is a community out there that already exists and you want to create your own, do it, right? Based on the questions that Michelle just suggested, because nobody's done it like you, because you are you and you are unique. So you have a different network or have different relationships and you're going to bring your flavor. So just make it happen. Just do it. Stop overthinking. Just do it.
That's a good point. I have one in Emma. And that's also part kind of in like the creating that business or organization model, which is look for groups out there before you start it too. Like take the time, because maybe someone else has already created it and maybe you can figure out how to contribute in the way that you think it's missing the content that you want. And or go, you can refer back to yourself and be like, I think this space is like created. It's like SFT is already a global space. And it has a lot of different people. So we have a lot of different content that's diverse. But if you want something more specific, then do it. Because that's what I did. I wanted something more specific, which is this only Filipinos. Not only Filipinos, because it's a group that's open to everyone who wants to celebrate or learn about our culture. Let me just make sure that's clear. But Remy said, do what you want when you pop in. Do you. Like, who's going to stop you, right? And if they do, like, what are they to you? Period, right?
Period. Exclamation mark. Bam. So because this show is called Hustle with Purpose, I have a two-part question. Number one, what does hustle mean to you?
Oh, hustle. I'm hustling, baby. Okay. Hustling for me growing up. When I think of when I was growing up, I mean, so I lived in a pretty middle lower class financial household. And my mom, like I said earlier, is my mom and father working for three of her, you know, Tres Marias growing up. And that woman is selfless. So my mom, number one, is an example for me as a hustler, grinding to make sure we have food on our table, a roof overhead, and not doing anything for herself. And there's pros and cons to just that statement I said. But I just say that in the fact that my mom is the most selfless person. And she hustled to make sure that we had a good future. And she hustled to make sure that she tried her best to make sure we grew up as ethical and kind human beings. And I respect my mom for that hustle. Because I look at her now, oh, I'm about to cry. Woo, I'm okay. It took me time to get older to realize and appreciate the way that she deserves to be treated as a hustling mom. I hope you can imagine, like, imagine a Filipino mom just working day in, two jobs, blah, 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 blah. Like, that's hustle to me. And that kind of aligns with, she was passionate about loving us. And that's what hustling is for me. It's pursuing your passion, pursuing what I'm passionate about. Or when I'm just hungry, for a curiosity. Because, like, just because you have curiosity doesn't mean you're super passionate already. But by acknowledging your curiosities and that they exist and doing something about it. And that's what my hustle was. I wanted to go on an avid trip. I didn't have the money. What I do? I sold chips every day. Two duffel bags. I left one in my coach's office. Thankfully, she didn't snitch. I was hustling first to fourth period. Y'all want chips? Like, y'all want chips? Comes with free candy. Like, what's up? Like, and I had notes for tabs. Like, oh, you didn't pay me today? Like, oh, so you got my dollar? Like, you know, it's the hustle that you don't even see the judgment. You got tunnel vision. That's hustling. You know, you just know when you're so hungry for something and nothing can stop you. I mean, you know, some things can hurt you, but, like, you just know that there's something that you're just not going to give up, and that you feel that energy just fired.
And so my second question to that is, what is your purpose behind your current hustle?
Okay. Oh, my current hustle is balancing my ability to grow independently and how I can help others grow and uplift themselves, whether it's community, my friends. Like, how am I present in my friendships and my relationships with my family and my community? But also the hustle is, how am I growing my brain? How am I growing my spiritual connectedness with myself? How am I increasing that connectedness with the things I care for? And how am I discerning what my priorities are? Especially with COVID right now, I'm grateful for the slowdown of society. It's felt like a race post-grad, because I just graduated 2019. And then I was like hustling, that hustle, right? I'm trying to hustle. Like, okay, I actually, so I was supposed to go to grad school after graduating at UCSB for technology management. And then I had a self-reflecting experience. This was also one of those hard decisions. And I ended up dropping out for multiple reasons before it started. So, okay, I don't have a job. I just dropped out. School was about to start in about a month. I also had gotten ACL surgery like 2 months before. So my mental health and my physical health was like, oh my God, like I can't move at the pace I want. It's about a year process. I'm moving back home. And I felt very lost. So over time, what did I do? I ended up joining a DJ school. And so currently my grind in line with that is that I'm currently grinding, trying to be an online DJ, serving the community with music, which I think is the most powerful healing tool for myself and I think for others. Number two is my relationships with my family and the people I care about, and really preserving that energy for them and myself. Number three is my community. How am I serving the community in the way that it aligns in my head and how I tell people? I can tell people I'm passionate about community. What you do with that? Like, I'm working on that right now, and I'm really grateful that you're allowing me to share that story, the story of SFT, with others.
Awesome. Well, I know you're going to continue to do so much dope work, because this is just the beginning. Like, we just entered the beginning of Michelle's story, so I look forward to the chapters that are going to be filled with so much greatness, girl. All right, so now we're going to get into some rapid-fire questions. Answer with the first thing that comes to mind, okay? Favorite day of the week?
Friday.
Favorite breakfast food?
Longanisa and rice, garlic rice and eggs.
Nickname your family used to call you growing up?
Oh my God. Thunder thighs.
What profession other than your own would you like to attempt?
Ooh. Vlogging.
What's a book or a movie that has inspired you?
The Inner Voice of Love, a book by a priest. I can't remember the name of the author, but one of my friends in the Philippines, she gave it to me, and it's an amazing book about love.
Who haven't you worked with yet that you would like to work with?
Ooh, okay, I guess I have to say the name that's on top of my head. Her name's Rosalyn. I have worked with her already a little bit, but like, I don't know why, but that's the name that came in. So if you're watching, like, I'm putting it into existence. Like,
all day, I'm linking that up. I mean, you guys already linked up, we'll make that happen. And that's what the importance of community is, helping each other out. If you could have three people over for dinner, dead or alive, who would they be?
My grandfather that passed away. Three people at the same time.
Sure, yes.
Or separately.
Up to you.
Okay, yeah, I would like to have dinner with my grandfather that passed away. I would like to have dinner with my uncle that passed away. And then I would like to have dinner with Michelle Obama.
What do you think the world needs more of?
The first word I think of is kindness, and to elaborate, I think it's more patience, a little more patience with each other. And I know this is multiple answers, but I don't care, I need to say it. I think right now, if we have nothing good to say, then maybe we shouldn't say it at all. And if we're not willing to understand the other side's perspective, then what's the point of judgment? Because I'm pretty sure if you really got to get to know the other side of who you're judging or talking down on, you're gonna grow. I mean, if you are human, you're gonna grow a little bit of empathy from a civil conversation with a side with another different perspective than you.
What do you think the world needs less of?
I think that's similarly, because judgment is kind of aligned with the hate that I'm seeing a lot of. And I think we can, like, if you're watching right now, raise your hand if you can tell me what good comes out of hate. You know, raise it. No one can, like, tell me. No one. What you're going to say, oh, like, it empowers people. But is there another way to empower people, right? There is. And then tell me if you contributed to hate before. All of our hands are going to go up. All of our hands are going to go up, Romeo, right? Oh, I'm at the crowd. I'm good. So it's like, if you know that any, like, what you're doing isn't going to contribute to anything, then don't do it. I'm okay. Hold on, pause. I'm not trying to cry.
What's happening within you right now? Please share your heart.
It's nice to talk about it, but like, I think that's the hard part about, I mean, it's just challenging to serve. You want to serve community because you're passionate about it, but you have to acknowledge like all the struggles that we're facing as a community, not just like Filipinos, but like everyone. And I think as an older sister, and I like to watch, and like I told you, I like to learn about people. So like, I think there's a pro and con to like empathy, because like when I feel so like I feel a lot. Like it's one thing for me to have experienced the downfalls within my own living experience, but there's a different sad energy that I feel because I'm facing the reality of the global world right now. Like, it's just sad to see, like, to really face, like, we're in a pandemic. There's racism and bigotry that's still existing, like, belligerently. You know, as a woman growing up, like, I have two younger sisters, and what is this world becoming for women? And what is the socialization of the goals of women now? And, you know, but I try, like I said, right, trying to look at the far side and thinking about what can I do in my control? Yeah.
Ooh. Thank you for sharing that.
I'm good.
Thank you for sharing that. But you acknowledged, and I know that's something by saying, you know, I'm good, but these feelings are coming out, acknowledge it, and it's okay to be good at the same time. But you being just you being real, you being true, and just you sharing what's on your heart, like, that's living life. That's living just life. That's the big L. We talked about the small L's, like the lessons, but you're living that big L just by being authentically you. So I appreciate that. And so my last question to you is, what do you, Michelle, want to be remembered for?
Oh, the first thing that comes to my mind, there's two things though, is my universal purpose in life is to hopefully leave people and places better than I found them, right? And I just want people to remember me as a light in their life in any way. Like, I don't, being kind to people and trying to be a decent person in life, it's not a financial thing. I don't have to donate. It's just the time and that little thoughtful remark of like, I don't want to be toxic in this space. I don't understand everyone here. There's no point of me to bring this harmful energy. And I want to inspire people to have that same mentality and to think like, it's not that hard to be kind. It's not that hard to smile at the car next to you. That's kind of weird sometimes. Like, really, like it's like the psychology of it that I'm passionate about it because I felt it. I felt what being just kind to others is, and to hopefully inspire them to spread it. Because at the end of the day, you're right, we don't live independently, and it's undeniable that we are producers and consumers of each other. But is that all we want to be moving forward, or do we want to love? I think everyone wants to feel connected. I won't speak for everyone with those I statements, right? I want to feel connected with people. I love being connected with people in a vulnerable and just genuine way. And so I hope that every person I cross by in some way or form that I inspire them or just make them feel good. It doesn't have to be inspirational. Like, I just want them to remember me. Like, oh, she brought the vibe.
And you are definitely doing that, Michelle. Keep it up. I'm proud of you because you definitely are a light. So, Michelle, where can people find you, connect with you, in case they want to, you know, reach out to you?
Well, my MySpace, no, I'm kidding. I have a Facebook, I have an Instagram, I have Twitter, I have Spotify, and I have, well, Spotify for the people who just want to plug into the music I listen to, and I have a SoundCloud where I also post my DJ mixes occasionally. Feel free to connect to me there. Also, you can find me, a part of my amazing administrative team, on Soto Filipino Traits. We have a group, we have it on Facebook, and we have a page on Facebook. You're gonna wanna join the group because that's where the community really is engaging. And then we have an Instagram. So all those handles, I think, will be below. There's my vlogger practice.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Michelle. I appreciate you, and continue to inspire the world with all that you do.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for watching. And thank you, Romeo and the Kollective Hustle team, for doing this. And yeah, bye.
Peace.